Okay. So, welcome to my presentation. My name is Pavel Paclik, and I would like to speak with you about machine learning, and especially how machine learning, I believe, is a technology that can enable new types of vision applications and bring us basically forward to new types of use cases. First, let me give a quick intro. I come from a company called PRSys Design. We are a Dutch company, a spin-off of Technical University Delft, where there is more than 30 years of experience in pattern recognition and machine learning. And we were created to basically bring practical machine learning to industry, to enable people in industry to adopt machine learning as a technology. We started with consulting projects, and we developed our own software tool that we provide to other people, to R&D researchers, and we provide also training courses. Our customer base is very diverse. It's from startups that are working on some kind of new technology that involves decision making, to established companies with big R&D teams developing very different applications, many of them in imaging and vision type, and many also in with different types of data, like, let's say, credit card fraud detection or brain-computer interfaces, for example. In this presentation, I would like to actually speak about machine learning as a technology. And maybe the first thing to ask the audience is, who has the experience with machine learning as a technique? Are there people who use that in projects or know what does that actually mean? Okay, thank you. I would like to go through a quick example of what I mean by that and what is the process of building a machine learning algorithm, and then a few examples of what you can expect from it, where it can help, or where we saw it practically used and helpful. But then I would like to focus on things that are not so often discussed, and that is, what are the risks for you as a, let's say, system integrator or R&D specialist that want to implement this technology, okay? And in the end, I would like to also speak about some lessons that we learned, how machine learning can help to basically make better results in vision projects and make it faster. So let me start with a classical design of machine vision systems. I think that what we basically do in machine vision so far is that we try to define our lighting, we try to define our conditions so that our objects are looking good. Looking good meaning subjectively looking good to us as designers. And then we are hand-tuning series of steps to extract meaningful information from it, again, looking at one or few images. And I think that this process is today quite subjective in many applications. Of course, there are applications where more sophisticated things are done, but the most of the industry is, I think, still doing these simple steps and looking at few images. We often try to find out kind of single good feature that will separate what we are really looking for. What I mean by that is that we have, let's say, objects and we want to separate the background, and we are doing everything we can with our lighting and pre-processing to separate, let's say, particles and the background so that we can make a simple threshold and we have our decisions and we can use that information. Now, in number of applications, this is actually not working so well. And the hand tweaking strategy and looking at few images is failing. Example could be anything that is with uncontrolled lighting. If you go outdoors, if you want to build a service robot that is interacting with people in their home, or look at intelligent car or anything in agriculture, basically, you have problem because the lighting cannot be controlled, or at least not so well. Another big group, I think, are applications where we look at natural objects, and that is due to the variability there. It's so high. I mean, you have so many types of defects, so many types of varieties of potatoes, that if you want to sort potatoes, it's just not a thresholding, and there is certainly not a single good feature that you can use for that. I think that the third group of applications are projects where whatever we do, in the end, we define our performance requirements in terms of probabilities, and that you cannot do from one or few images. You really need to look at large sets of observations. So in these applications, looking at few images and hand tweaking is not really so good, but what we can still do is to actually use statistical learning. And that's machine learning or pattern recognition, which for me is kind of a synonymous thing. That's what I would like to speak in this presentation. To give you a quick example, how does it work? I chose a multispectral image segmentation problem that we worked on for a Unilever R&D. What we are looking at is a granule of a washing powder. It's embedded in some matrix, and we are looking with a microscopic system on it. We have four different bands of this image, and they are looking at different, let's say, chemical compounds. Our goal would be to segment out the particle. So it's quite a well-defined thing. But if I try to do that with just thresholding on any of these bands, I will always end up in very poor solution, because I always lose a lot of particle, or I always overshoot a lot of background. It's just not a type of thresholding task, and not simple task to do. In machine learning kind of approach, we do it differently. We basically show examples of what we mean by the particle. That's the labeled, let's say, red part, and what we mean by the background. So here I prepared a data set that actually is still one image, but we have like 4,400 examples, meaning labeled pixels, from these two categories. Now, this is just image view that is, of course, obvious, but the same data can be viewed in a different way, and that's much more useful for machine learning, and that's the scatter plot. And often when we show this, people just shy away and they don't want to talk about it anymore, especially at management level. This is kind of difficult image, but I still try to show it here. I think it's very important to understand, because then you understand what the statistical learning actually is doing. So we look at the same data. One point in that plot is one pixel in my image. Now, on the left side of the image, we of course look at one band at a time. On the right side, the scatter plot is looking at two bands. So we are looking at correlations between bands, and that's becoming very important for us for statistical learning. At the bottom, you can see the distribution, so the histograms for the class, the red class, the particle, the blue class, the background. You can see that if on any of these two bands I put a threshold, I will not have a good solution because they are overlapping. But you can also see that the clouds that we have in this feature space, how we call it, actually can be quite well separated, as we will see later, if we use the correlations. Now, we of course don't have just two, but we have more components. So if we just focus on these two classes, we can flip through different combinations of features. So scatterplot will help you to look at multidimensional data, but it's still the same set of pixels as we have on the left. So that's just two views of the same data. Let's move on. If I know that I have correlations in my data, I would choose some very simple classifier that can use it. And in this case, it's just a Gaussian model. What I show here is how a classifier actually looks like. So what I'm plotting for a subset of my training data is the model trained on each of the classes. The model trained meaning estimated Gaussian distribution. And what we plot there is the response of the model. The color is proportional to the probability. So if there is a red color in the background, it means that it's highly probable that particle on the left or background on the right is appearing on that spot, right? This is basically the model itself. That's what we call soft outputs of a model, that it's always converted to decisions. The same classifier are now giving crisp decisions. The red part, that's where the classifier will show this is the particle. The blue part, this is the background. You can see that we did not find out a thresholding kind of solution. We found out a solution that works with both bands. The same kind of classifier on the image gives this. And then you can think about, well, is this machine learning actually any good? Because this is apparently not a good result, right? I have lots of errors in the background. And I think this is a very important point to make for everyone who is trying to use machine learning. Training a model is just first step. You really should optimize the model so that it does what you want in your application. There is no reason why a trained model on some data would be good. So what we need to do is actually optimize it. On the left side, I see decisions of my classifier, and on the right side, I see something that is called operating characteristic. This is what my classifier can do, and we also estimate that from the data. That plot is actually showing some performance indications. On one axis, it's what we call true positive rate, which you can basically say the fraction of true particle that we really find. On the other axis, we plot here the false positive rate, meaning what are the hits in the background. This is the trade-off. We would, of course, like to be here on the top, but we can't. Our classifier is not so good. The classifier can only be where are the blue points, right? The point is that as a designer of such system, you can tune the classifier, meaning change the operating point. So if I go to one side, I will make more errors in the background. If I go to the other side, I will start making holes in the particle. This kind of optimization helps you, this is just a simple example of it, to choose the point where you really want to operate, well, then we have the classifier, because then it's somehow tuned to your problem. So now I'm quite well classifying my particle. I can go finally to new images. On the left, you would see if it's not optimized. On the right, we see what happens if I optimize my system well. I've never seen these images in my design process. That's very important, right? And I am doing good on new particles. So this is, in a nutshell, what machine learning actually is. We have the sensory data. We must do some pre-processing and calibration that is not shown here. Often you need to generate or extract features. Well, we used the bands themselves as features. Then we train the model, we optimize it, and we can execute it and test it. So where can actually machine learning help in projects? So what kind of things you can imagine that where it is useful? I will give you some examples. We had a project on sorting rocks, so classifying minerals, rock types in a mining industry. So basically learning from local color information and texture information. We were able to show in this specific case that we can perform better than a human geologist. Important thing, from the same images. If you let the geologist touch the stone, they will always beat any kind of computer. But of course, on the conveyor belt, you don't want anyone to touch any stone, right? So that was a good, successful project. Another one, classifying the luggage at the airports, if it can be conveyed by the robotic system, or if there is a risk of jamming the system. It's a machine that works, is operating by Van der Lande Industries in different airports. There is, of course, high cost of failure, because if you do it wrong, people wait on the whole airport for baggage handling. Number of projects coming from agro and food industry. These are examples from Wageningen University, the boot on the other side. People there used our software for classifying, let's say in this case, tulip diseases in the field with multiband imaging, so live plants in the field, or looking with hyperspectral imaging at packaged products such as tomatoes. The colors here are the results of the classifier, and you can distinguish the tomatoes, the stems, the packaging, but also the yellow labels, that's for the rotten or too mature or damaged tomatoes. Last example, classifying face gender or person gender just from a single shot from appearance of a face in general illumination. You can see demo of that on our booth, the other side of the hall, close to the restaurant. So in general, it can help you with problems where you have high variability of your product, where you really need robustness and you cannot do it by other methods, but you can learn it from many examples. So if we have examples of human faces with different illumination, we can be more robust to general illumination, or where you want real performance optimization. So that's the nice thing. But now, what are the risks when you as designers want to implement these kind of systems? What you should be actually aware of? One thing that I would mention is that people don't realize that this is a statistical approach and you really need many examples. You should think about hundreds, you should think about thousands. Sometimes people come with a few images and they think that you can learn a complex concept. Well, I would say you can't. You really need repeatable data generation process and you need good quality labeling. The good news is that you can validate with these methods if you have good enough data amount, if you can really get good error bars, if you get good probability of error. The lesson that we learned is that it's actually better to have less data with good quality labeling than a lot of garbage that is actually not well labeled. It's a little bit against the mainstream, because what you see in the media is, of course, the Google mining of millions and millions of images and learning what the cat looks like. I believe that for industrial applications where you really need performance, you should go for good quality labeling first. The second kind of risk that I would mention is that our sensor may not contain the information that we need to discriminate what we are actually looking for. The problem is that we need to build classifiers to find it out. So we have a chicken and egg problem. We need to build classifiers to find out if we can build classifiers. But we can actually use machine learning to validate. It's a validation tool for me, and I will speak more about it in the future. One example that we saw in one of the projects was that a geologist claimed that we cannot distinguish certain minerals by a part of the spectrum simply because there were no peaks. And geologists, as experts, are looking for peaks to understand chemistry and understand the mineral composition. Well, we could do that because we could learn from correlations in this specific case. So even domain experts sometimes is misleading you about what is and what is not possible. I think that lesson learned and what we can benefit as industry is that you need a quick feasibility study, you need a quick analysis, quick turnaround to validate it. No one knows if it actually it is or it is not in the data. Other type of risk that I find very, very important to realize is that the data acquisition must be repeatable for these methods. And it kind of sounds obvious, but sometimes it's not. We had medical projects where we found out that actually medical devices are often built even today for visualization. And there is lots of nonlinear tweaking of the original signal. And it's actually not built for the objective diagnostics. Machine learning, again, can help you as a validation tool to find out if you have a repeatable data acquisition. Now, you can think, how is it done? So I would like to give two examples what can be useful in this situation. One is just about simple visual validation. This data comes from a medical problem where we were looking at cancer tissue characterization, basically. It's a 3D ultrasound sensor. This plot is showing data coming from multiple patients. One point is a part of tissue characterized in some set of, let's say, 10 or 11 features. And you can see two classes, disease and no disease. We can, of course, go through different combinations of features, and we saw that before. And you see these kind of clouds. You see clouds in the feature space. But at some moment in this project, we started to see this pattern. And that's very weird. This is not a cloud in the feature space. But these are kind of thin structures that are somehow aside of each other. Now, that looks weird. And we really looked more into it. But what you can do very simply with machine learning tools is just look at different set of labels on the same problem. So instead of cancer and non-cancer, we can look at labels like patients or scans. And once you do that, you see that every patient is a separate thin structure there. That basically means that we did not have well-normalized data. So in this case, we could see that visually, but we could only see that by putting all this data to one data set and looking at it with machine learning tools, not with computer vision tools. If you look at the original scans, you never see it because we just accommodate any kind of differences between gray level and you don't get it. So in this case, we had really bad pre-processing and we cannot find it by image inspection only. I think that this is one of the reasons why actually we cannot use only computer vision tools, but we should complement it with machine learning tools. These are not two competing things, it's complementing technology. Second example that is related to validation of these ideas is just starting with a simple question. Can you really trust your classifier? So if I go back to my problem with the detergent with the washing powder particles, and I can see that classifier on the top. Now, any data that I throw on that classifier will end up somewhere in my feature space, and I will always make the decision red or blue, particle or the background. So I get new data, I get new decisions, but do you trust a decision that would be at that spot in my feature space? Do you trust a point that ends up over here? Well, I think that you really shouldn't, because we never had any training data there. Most classifiers that are today built and used are just giving you good or bad or quality one or two, cancer, non-cancer, but people do not care so much about, well, actually, I have not seen it in training. We find it really important because if we add this possibility of rejecting things far away from the training data, suddenly we can find out that some parts of the images were simply never represented and we are just making decisions but not knowing why. This is actually not a bad situation. The bad situation is if half of your scan is rejected and you will never know if you don't use this kind of techniques. Back to the risks. I think that it's also really important to have realistic expectations about this technology. What we often hear from system integrators is, look, academy can do, let's say, 95% performance and it's good enough for them, but we need 100%. Well, I would argue that there are many problems where it's not possible to achieve 100%, but it also does not matter. No one can claim that they can sort potatoes with 100% accuracy, but we can all buy sorted potatoes in a supermarket, so there is a business case for it. And I really believe that this is the biggest opportunity for the industry that we are actually now facing, because we can go to applications where we can have good enough solutions. It's just about finding what is good enough. It's not about perfect solutions. So let me now share with you what we learned as kind of major lessons in how I think the machine vision can be kind of pushed forward with this kind of technology. The first lesson is about this validation. I really think that machine learning can be used to validate ideas, and that it's kind of part of the feedback loop. When we are building classifiers for clients, only 20% of our work is really building a classifier. Everyone can build a classifier. The question is it a good one? The question is, where do I build it? So that is the major part of the work, finding good representation, representative features, or good representation of your problem. But I would also say, very big part of our work is interpreting, after the classifier is made, why it doesn't work, where it fails, and why does it fail. And that is really, really, really useful. If you look at machine learning as a part of feedback loop, typically people think about it as a linear process, right? You just give your data to machine learning expert, he goes somewhere, he's sitting somewhere in his office, and he does the job because he's the optimal guy, he knows what to do. Well, there is a mismatch between that. So I really believe that if you have this question, how can we go with machine learning and outsource it in the cloud, for example, okay? Do it somewhere far away from you? Well, I think you can't. You really should do it other way around. You should bring it to your team. It can be working with external machine learning expert. I'm the last one to tell you not to do that. But there should be high interaction. There should be really interaction between many people on the team. To give you an example from our medical project, we found out through this machine learning kind of techniques, together with other people of the team, that we had bad scan normalization, but really going to such details as calling in the experts that were producing the probes and finding that some part of the process was analog and not well understood and not really repeatable, or finding bugs in the feature extraction code, or finding bad labeling. It happens that even experts flip your labels. If you use correctly machine learning, you will find out weird performance. If you go back and try to understand why, you can really trace these things. So that, I think, is really a useful way to do that. The second lesson is, I think we can benefit a lot if we bring very quickly the machine learning concepts and ideas, algorithms, to prototype machines. What I mean by that is that there is today a gap between analyzing the data and doing some kind of work on the statistical methods, and actually building it in a prototype and testing it on real-world situation, on the conveyor belt, in the medical scan, and so on. Often it takes weeks or months, because there is really this R&D split. I think that it's not useful. I think it should be really done a bit better, and we worked very hard to make it faster. What is today happening is that researcher makes an algorithm in completely data analysis environment, like, let's say, MATLAB or Python or anything. Then it goes to developers who code it, and then finally, after a few weeks, it runs in a machine. Of course, then you find out that something doesn't work, but the way back is very, very complicated. So imagine what would happen if you can actually bring it in a minute in a machine, that you go from your data analysis environment to the machine. It is possible today, and the most important thing is what it actually enables you to do. I think it enables you to find the real issues, because often they are not represented in our design data sets that we collect and label, right? So it is about a fast iteration, and it's about finding the problems very early on. So finally, my conclusions would be that I believe that machine learning is really enabling new types of applications that work with natural objects, work with humans, animals, unconstrained environments, but it requires specific methodology. You cannot just have a GUI interface, few clicks, and you are done. For simple problems, yes. For real problems, I don't believe it. But the good news is that it's available today. This technology went out from the university research. It's practically available. There are tools, there are training courses, there is a methodology that works. So basically, you can adopt it if you want. And what I really believe is that the highest benefits are if it gets integrated very close to the rest of the R&D team and people cooperate and use machine learning experts to help them to validate and understand, and that you can, if you can quickly test things in your prototypes. These two things, I believe, can really help us in machine vision community. So that's all from me. If you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer them.